Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Today we're going to do a take on a tart tatin. The method I'm going to use today was popularized by a French chef pâtissier, William Lamagnère, but I'm not going to fully follow his recipe. I'll link to his recipe below. I'm going to make some changes along the way because he uses some ingredients that I can't get readily here where I live, especially the apples. None of the local growers grow the apple that he uses. And I'm going to change the caramel a little bit because he uses a very specific French olive oil that, although I can get it, it's so super expensive that I don't know that it's going to bring anything special for me. So I'm going to change the caramel sauce to be a little bit more like the one they use at Noma, which is a fantastic restaurant. If you ever get a chance to go to the restaurant or to one of their pop-ups, I would highly suggest that you do it, although I do realize it's not for everybody. So in this pot, I'm going to put some sugar. We're going to make the caramel for the bottom or the top, the eventual top of the tart tatin. So I know a lot of people are a little bit scared of making caramel on a stovetop, so I'm going to show you a couple of tricks. Just add maybe 2 tablespoons of water. That helps dissolve the sugar a little bit faster. And then I'm going to add about 1.5 teaspoons of corn syrup. Corn syrup is an invert sugar. This one is all glucose. Not all corn syrup is high fructose corn syrup. They're related, but they're different. This one is just glucose. And what that glucose does is it stops the sugar from crystallizing as it caramelizes, which means that you can stir it through the entire process and have a little bit more control of what's happening. Now, you don't have to put the water in, you don't have to put the corn syrup in, you could just put the sugar in, leave it on the stovetop, don't stir it, and let it caramelize or brown on its own. But I know that for a lot of beginner cooks, or people that don't do it every day or really often, there is that urge to stir. And so, if it makes you feel comfortable, those 2 additions will certainly help you out. Now, as this starts to brown, you can see it bubbling away there. Traditionally, you would just swirl it if you did anything. But you can just leave it to go, let it bubble. And as soon as it reaches a point where you think it's brown enough and it starts to smell really caramely to you, it's time to pull it off. The caramel is almost ready. Now, before I started this, I got the baking pan ready. I've got this little 9-inch cake pan, buttered it generously inside, and I've put a parchment disc in the bottom just to make sure that nothing sticks. It's never stuck on me before, but you know that on camera, that's when it's going to happen. So that's all ready to go, soon as the caramel is ready. Okay, I'm calling it. It's just starting to smoke. It's just gone a little bit past that light brown stage and is starting to get into that dark brown stage. There's going to be some carryover cooking because this is a heavy bottom pot and it will continue cooking it. And whatever you do, if you do get little crystals on the side of the pot, resist the urge to scrape them off and back into the caramel because it'll just seize. Next, I've got some salted butter, just regular salted butter, and I'm going to stir that into the caramel sauce. It's going to bubble up. That's fine. That's what it's supposed to do. And then next, I'm going to put in about 1 teaspoon of soy sauce. And be careful. Don't go overboard. You just want a little bit, and we'll stir that in. Now, I'm using tamari, which is a Japanese brewed soy sauce. You could use any soy sauce that you like the flavor of, and if you want a lighter flavor, just use less. It doesn't take much to really bring out all of these dark, earthy, salty flavors. So, caramel's looking good, and we pour it into the bottom of the cake pan. And we'll just set this aside while we deal with the apples. Now for the fun part, which is to sort of delaminate these apples. I'm using Northern Spy because that's what the grower up the road had when I went there this week. And I'm just going to top and tail the apple, top and bottom off. And I've got this, I don't know what you'd even call it. It's kind of like how you would make plywood. And I'm sure this machine has a name, but I am not totally acquainted with what it's called. So you put the apple in. Kind of try to center it. There is a knife blade here that is very sharp. So you put it on and you turn the crank. It takes a little bit until you get the apple round. So now we've got these long, thin strips of apple, and they are very delicate, very thin, and we want to roll them up so that we get around inside the pan. You're essentially delaminating it to roll it back up, almost like making a rolled plywood. And like so many things in the kitchen, take your time. It's not a race. Take your time and try to do it without being too sloppy. There we go. The first couple times I made this was almost a complete disaster. I didn't have this stainless steel version. I bought one of these off of Amazon. Dozens of different manufacturers, but they're all exactly the same. And they don't work all that great. So if you get one of those, you're just gonna have to take your time. It is time consuming. But in the end, it looks really cool. It's worth it. So I'm just gonna continue rolling up the apple. And you have to decide how much of this red peel you want. You can take the time to cut it all off, or you could live with a little bit around the top or the bottom. Depends what you want. I found that for this size pan and the size apples I'm using, 6 or 7 apples gets me the right size of round of apples. And the other thing I'd like to do is actually make it a little bit bigger than the pan and then squeeze it in. That gives me a better shape later on. It's a delicate operation, and as you can see, the apple does start to pull apart. So it's not always going to be perfect, but it is still going to look amazing and taste incredible. Okay, so let's see, can we get it in? Not what I would call super pretty, but once it bakes, everything will be fine. So into the oven we go. Now at about the halfway point through the bake, you want to pull it out and squish down the apples. Smells really good. And just tamp it down. That gets all of the liquid all over and also sort of compresses it a little bit to help with the baking. That's good. And back into the oven. I am going to say that the apple is done. So I'm going to pull that out. And now we'll make the puff pastry crust. And I'm not actually going to make puff pastry. I've got the stuff from the freezer at the supermarket. And there's a few different ones available where we live. Some of them are absolutely horrible. This one is all butter. There's a couple that you can get that use a bunch of different oils, and they've just got a taste that I don't like. If you find one that works for you, I see no problem in buying it because it can be a bit of a pain in the arse to make. So I'm going to roll this out. I have another cake tin, same size as that cake tin. If you don't have two, I would do this before you do the apples. And I just want to make a round that is slightly smaller than the cake tin. So I'll just press that in and then cut it with a knife. Mostly round, doesn't have to be exact. It will change shape a little bit as it cooks anyway. And I put that onto a baking tray that has a little bit of parchment paper and then hit it with some powdered sugar on top. And into the oven to bake. And when I pull that out of the oven, it has caramelized nicely. So now we need to get this together with the apple. And I want to put the caramelized sugar side against the apple. So basically flip it around without burning yourself. There we go. And then flip the whole thing onto a cake plate. Still not terribly pretty, but this is looking pretty good, Jules. Look at that.
Works. Hey, friends.
So let's get, I'm just going to cut one little piece because we still haven't finished eating our dinner. No, look at that.
We've just been tasting. That looks great. How many apples are in there?
Seven or eight. You'll know because you just heard me say it. I've already forgotten how many there were. And.
That is apple-y and refreshing and lovely. Just a pleasant experience all around.
Okay. Can you guess the secret ingredient?
Not really, but there is a hint to it being very similar to the caramel sauce that you made on the weekend.
Yes. So I dialed back the soy sauce a little bit. And it is
it the same caramel sauce?
It's the same caramel sauce.
Huh.
So I dialed back the soy just a little bit and it is lifting the apple. It's making the apple more apple.
Well, it's like that, you know, when you put salt on things, it just kind of brings that flavor out. Yeah. So it's bringing out those flavors.
So it's got a deep, earthy undertone to the apple. So don't be afraid of the soy sauce. Don't put too much soy sauce in, though.
It was a little too much on our test on the weekend.
On the test. Oh, it was too much for the test on the weekend. We're supposed to have whipped cream.
Hey, everything's better that way.
Everything's better with whipped cream. So, yes, the French pastry chef puts whipped cream on it.
Okay.
Although I'm sure he doesn't do spray whipped cream. He probably makes it into a quenelle and puts, he does put gelatin in and makes little quenelles with it so that the cream is really stiff.
I gotta tell you, not concerned.
No. I'm fine with spray whipped cream. Okay, so this is really good. Well worth the effort of skinning those apples and turning them. And my technique for putting the apples together isn't quite there yet. Probably should make 25 or 30 of them before you get it perfect, but I think that looks pretty good still.
Tastes good.
Yeah, tastes good. Thanks for checking this out. Check out the smoked beef rib recipe and the cornbread recipe. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.